walking through the process of performing an operational modal analysis for you today in SimCenter Test Lab. So I've started a project here that contains some time history data. I took my SCADIS XS, I glued some accelerometers onto my snowboard, and I rode the snowboard while recording some acceleration data. So you see I've got a wireframe geometry here. I'll use this to help visualize the mode shapes that we're going to calculate in this process. And then I have my time history data from my various accelerometers here. After that, I need to load in the software that I'm going to use to perform the operational modal analysis. So you see operational modal analysis here in the add-ins list, as well as the Polymax curve fitter that I can add on top of the operational modal analysis. So these two products are loaded currently, and it's ready to get started. So I'll load my time history data into the input basket, and I'll move to this operational data collection page. Operational modal analysis is going to curve fit some cross power functions. We're going to use these time histories to produce or calculate those cross power functions, and the operational data collection page is where I do that. So you see all of my measurement locations appear up here, and I've selected two reference locations, the back left of the snowboard and the front right. And I'm trying to select a reference from sort of each section of the snowboard, so the left and the right and the front and the back, and that's how I got to these two references. These settings down here in this processing of cross powers dialog, you see number of time lags and then this exponential window percentage. This resolution shown here is going to be affected by this number of time lags. And it's also going to be displayed in this quick function window. And right now I'm choosing to select the cross correlation and unwindowed cross correlation function. Cross correlation is sort of a time domain impulse response function. And then the cross power is going to be our frequency domain function that we're going to calculate. So I've selected a reference, I've selected a response location here, and I'm going to put it back on cross correlation and unwindowed cross correlation. And you see it's time domain, and I've got 2 seconds of data here. 2 seconds of data, the inverse of that is 1/2, and so that's how my resolution ends up being 0.5 hertz here. And the setting that I changed to control this resolution and the amount of time that appears in this window is the number of time lags. So if I increase this number of time lags, say to 1024, you'll see now I have 4 seconds of data and I have 1/4 hertz resolution. Okay, so this is essentially how many steps do you want me to make in the time domain, and that will obviously affect my frequency resolution. So if I look at my cross power function, you'll see the spectral resolution is much different here than if I put this at 512. You see the frequency resolution goes down, or if I go to 256. Obviously the number of frequency lines is changing here, and so my function is going to change accordingly. What I'm really looking at right now, at least in this step, is I want to balance this frequency resolution and this exponential window setting to achieve two things. I want it to give me a decent frequency resolution in my cross power function, and then so I like 512 here. That gives me 0.5 hertz resolution, and again this is a balance between being able to separate two closely spaced mode shapes in this function and kind of reducing the spikiness or the noise in the data. Okay, so I'm going to choose 0.5 hertz just from some experience I have, and now I'm going to work on this exponential window setting. So I'm going to look at the cross correlation and unwindowed cross correlation, and what I'm looking for here is you see a red function and a blue function. One of them is the windowed cross power or cross correlation, one of them is the unwindowed cross correlation function. And what I'm going to do is I'd like this cross correlation function to die out to zero by the end of this time window. Okay, so just like in impact testing, if I'm hitting my structure, I want to make sure that structure sort of stops moving by the end of my observation window to prevent leakage. Same exact thing here. And so I'm going to adjust this exponential window percentage to ensure that this time domain function is zero or pretty darn close to zero by the end of this time window. So the window percentage here means I'm going to take the function and the windowed version will have this percentage of the unwindowed function's amplitude by the end of the time window. So 100% means the windowed function is going to have 100% of the amplitude of the unwindowed function, so they are the exact same. If I put this at 10%, we'll now see the blue curve starts to die out. It's getting closer to zero. It's still not quite low enough for my preference. And so I'm going to lower this a little bit more to say 1%. By 1%, that means this blue curve has 1% of the amplitude of the red curve here at the end. Okay, and there's an article on the community that explains this exponential window in a little bit more detail if you're interested. So you see the difference between the windowed and unwindowed function. I'm seeing the effect of the damping here. And I can also check out the windowed and unwindowed cross power function. Again, red is unwindowed, blue has this exponential window applied, and you see the sort of damping effect of this window. I like the looks of my blue cross power here. I'm going to check a couple different response locations just to see if I like the effect everywhere. Looks pretty good. And so I'm ready to process these cross powers. Right now it's going to go into a run called operational pre-processing. Sometimes it's helpful to put some of these parameters in here. So I might say 512 and 1%. This will tell me that I have 512 time lags and 1% exponential window percentage for these cross powers. I can then calculate those. I might make some adjustments and create multiple sets of operational cross powers and then curve fit them all and see which ones I like the best. Okay, there's really no harm in doing a couple different settings, seeing which ones give me the results that I like the best. Keeping track of these settings in the run name will just help me keep the results straight when I get there. So if I go to the Navigator page, you see I now have this operational pre-processing folder. I look in here and there are some cross powers, a folder for each of my references. And so now I'm going to start the curve fitting process using these calculated cross powers. So I'm going to right click here, replace whatever's in my input basket with these cross powers. And now I'm ready to go into this operational data selection page. Here I'm going to say look in the input basket and find all the data that's in there. So I have two references. I have the back left and the front right locations, and then all of my measurements. I've also chosen to show the sum of the included cross powers. So if I just show you that, it's this red curve up here. And then I also like to look at each of my cross powers that I calculated by turning on this box here, selected cross powers. Now as I click around, that green function will change and it will be compared to that sum function. This is a way for me to just visually check all of the cross powers that I calculated, make sure nothing is awry here, and I'm feeling comfortable to move on to the curve fitting process. Everything looks pretty good. I'm going to move on with all of these cross powers included. So my next step is to move on to this operational Polymax page. This is where I'll do the curve fitting process. This is identical to the process for an experimental or regular modal analysis. So if you're familiar with that, this will be no different. I'm going to first select a bandwidth, and then I'm going to look at a stabilization diagram, select my poles, and then I'll be able to look at mode shapes after that. Some of the things I've shown here on this bandwidth selection page, I am showing that sum function. So you see the red function is the sum of all my cross powers. And then I've also shown this MIF or mode indicator function. And you see I have a blue and a green mode indicator function. That is because I have two references, so I can actually have two mode indicator functions. You can have a MIF for each reference that you have in your data set. Because I have two references, I can view both MIFs. In this case, I am trying to set this double cursor across the frequency band that I want to calculate poles or modes or mode shapes over. So what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to capture the major peaks in the sum function as well as these mode indicator functions are sort of functions designed to help me identify modes. And so where they peak, they're also trying to tell me, yeah, there's a mode there wherever you see this blue or this green function peaking up. And so I want to set my bandwidth kind of where all of these green, blue, and red functions are at a minimum. Okay, they're not peaking. I don't want to set my cursor here because it's right in the middle of this red peak. I'd really want to be at sort of a valley in all of these functions. So this bandwidth looks pretty good. I'm going to tell the computer, find me all the modes between 12.5 and basically 80 hertz and see what I can figure out. Okay. Next, I move on to the stabilization page. And here's where that Polymax curve fitter that we added in is really going to benefit us, because we're going to get a much cleaner stabilization diagram than we would with, say, that Time MDOF curve fitter. Works fine. This is just going to make the process easier for us. So if I start by looking at a model size of 50, this essentially controls the number of solutions that I'm looking for over on the right-hand side. And what I'm looking for are columns of S's, okay? And so I can come in here and I can select some S's. You see here's a mode at 19 hertz. Grab one of these guys, and then I see these two S's up here. Okay, so I've selected my poles. My next step is to now go into this shapes and actually calculate these mode shapes based on those poles. So I'm calculating, I'm including the lower and upper residuals. You can view the modal analysis curve fitting article to get some more explanation on what those are. I'm going to calculate my mode shapes, and now I can look at my results. So I've got four modes in the band between 18 and 80. And so I see this mode at 19 hertz is basically a first bending mode. It's a little bit dominated by the front of the board here. I'll look at this 25 and a half, sort of rear dominated bending. And then I have two modes very close at 54.2. So this is sort of torsion front and rear, out of phase. And you notice the middle section of the board doesn't participate very much in any of these mode shapes, and that's really because my rider is standing on the board, and so he's kind of constraining that part of the board, so it's not going to participate in these mode shapes like it would in a true free experimental modal. So that's kind of expected result there. And then this 54 looks like torsion, where the front and the rear are in phase. The last step is to go to this operational synthesis page, and this will allow me to sort of check the synthesized cross powers that I calculated and see if, make sure that they are capturing all of the dynamic behavior that I'm interested in capturing. And so I'll look at my math model versus my measured data. And so I'm looking to compare this green, which is the synthesized, and compare it to the red functions, which are my measured data. And so if I step through these, I'm looking for the green to sort of capture the major behavior found in the red. The red is operational data, so it's going to have a lot of noise in it, and so I'm just making sure that I'm capturing the main dynamic behavior of the system found in the red measurements. I'm capturing those behaviors in the green synthesized functions. If I don't like the looks or the amount of error in some of these, I might go back, try a different cross power set, or select a couple different additional modes. I happen to like the mode shapes I got, and for my purposes, they meet my needs of figuring out the front end bending and torsion modes of my snowboard. So I'm going to stop there. But that's the process. I can sort of iterate, find more modes, change my cross power calculation settings, and see how that affects my results. And that's operational modal in SimCenter Test Lab.